Welcome to Wide Angle. I'm Aaron Brown. We end our season with a story that for us began right about this time in 2003. That's when we began following seven children in seven countries as they strive for, in many cases fought for, a basic education. For all their effort and their struggle, they are lucky. 75 million kids around the world can't go to school. Tens of millions more will be forced to leave school long before their education is complete. Last week we introduced you, or reintroduced you, to four of our seven. Tonight, the final three. Two extraordinary young women in Benin and Romania, and a remarkable young man from Kenya. Each of these stories is different. Each child faces different challenges, different family circumstances, different cultural issues. But they share a common bond, a knowledge that the road to their futures must pass through a schoolhouse, a classroom, no matter how hard that may be. After the film, I'll be back to chat with an international singing star who also happens to be a UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador whose focus is on girls' education, Angelique Kidjo. Stay with us.
Everywhere in the world, parents want what's best for their children. And children have dreams for their future.
Sometimes I see my country's leaders on TV, and I say, if only I could represent my country someday.
Fulfilling those dreams almost always requires an education. But in many countries, that's far from a given. That's why in the year 2000, 189 nations made a vow to provide a free basic education to every child, everywhere, by 2015.
Nowadays, in slums or even everywhere,
education is the key. Nothing comes without learning.
We have been tracking that promise in some of the world's best schools and in some of its most precarious, through the lives of seven children in seven countries.
Ago when you came here, I was a child and I played a lot. 3 years ago, I was very different. I had horrible hair.
Now they've reached adolescence, the time when kids are most at risk of dropping out. This is the turning point. This is Time for School 3.
Dialore nyonungbe noko bono kwe molu isokmaru tagwe. Dialore nyonungbe noko bono kwe molu isokmaru tagwe.
How are you? I love you.
Three years ago when you came, I was a child.
Me too.
But now I've grown up a little bit.
14-year-old Nanavi is growing up in Kutagba, a remote village in the tiny West African country of Benin, and a place where tradition holds sway.
I worship voodoo. Here in our village, people don't go to church.
Voodoo was born in Benin, and two-thirds of its people are followers. The voodoo priests here have always demanded that young girls spend years being initiated into the cult and readied for marriage, instead of going to school. But when we first met Nanavi in 2003, at the age of 8, a nationwide campaign to educate the girls of Benin had come to Kutagba. The voodoo priest called for celebration because he had just agreed to allow one girl from each family to attend school. Nanavi was one of the lucky chosen.
I want Nanavi to go to school. But all the girls can never go to school. There'll always be those who go to the convent. No one can force me to release all of them for school.
Nearly half of the girls in Benin have had no formal education and often marry very young. Regina Gedu was trying to change that. She had a key role in Benin's girls' education initiative and persuaded the voodoo priest of the value of letting girls go to school. She also traveled from village to village on a mission to spread this new way of thinking.
If there are too many illiterate people, the country can't develop. We need these children of tomorrow so that the country can change. But this will be a long fight.
The oldest of four children, Nanavi was the biggest help on the family's modest farm. Sending her to school meant sacrificing that help. But Nanavi's mother thought education was a better investment in her 8-year-old daughter's future.
I hope that she'll become something great, like a doctor. If I'd gone to school, I'd have had a better life.
Nanavi's father owned a corn mill, and unlike many in this deeply traditional community, he was supportive of girls' education. The changes that girls' education will bring to the village are huge. The girls who attend school learn about hygiene. For instance, she won't let her baby go without vaccination against diseases. She can help her mother count the money they made at the market. Like all girls recruited into the program, Nanavi was assigned an older student as her mentor, Marguerite. An excellent student herself, Marguerite would try to ensure that Nanavi did well in school.
Nanavi works very well. She has trouble with the number 3, and I'm helping her with that.
When we returned in 2006, Nanavi had suffered a tragic loss. Her father had died. leaving the family devastated.
When my father died, I felt like dying too. He used to play with me. If I didn't come back from school and it was getting dark, my father would pick me up in the village. This is my father's corn mill. Since he died, it doesn't work anymore.
Since my husband's death, I've been suffering. Who will support my children with me? The fields are all we have to live on.
Having lost her husband's income, Nanavi's mother needed her daughter's help on the farm more than ever. But Nanavi's father had made one last wish.
My father told me to go to school and not to rest.
Marguerite, Nanavi's mentor, kept an especially close watch on her in the weeks following her father's death.
I told her to keep going to school, and if she needed chalk, I'd give her some. Her father's death shouldn't be an excuse to abandon school.
Just 3 years into her education, Nanavi was already holding on to her enrollment by a thread.
This is my middle school. This is the sixth grade. And this is my classroom. I'm taking math, physics, biology, history, geography, French, and English.
Nanavi's $30 school fee was hard for the family to come up with. They got help from an uncle and a discount from the school.
Okay, so everybody sign up. Nanavi, what is the plural of demonstrative of that term? Don't say here, here, okay? You just raise your hand and then I will call you, okay? Okay, now class, look at it. Is it correct?
Yes.
It's correct?
Yes.
Now you clap up for Nanavi.
6 years into her education, Nanavi is in the select 11% of Benin's girls who have even made it this far.
I believe that Nanavi can make it. As we say, with a valiant heart, nothing's impossible. But even if Nanavi dropped out today, there is a great difference in her life if you compare her to someone who's never been to school.
Qu'est-ce que tu cherches?
Marguerite is in the eighth grade and the only girl in her class. She still watches over Nanavi.
I help her with her homework, but we don't have books. Nanavi does well in physics and math. She doesn't do well in biology, French, and history.
Marguerite and Nanavi almost always walk home together. It's 2 hours each way from their village. The long commute weeds out all but the most motivated students. And there's another obstacle to staying in school. Nanavi is starting to get attention from boys.
Once a girl gets her diploma, she can find a husband. But the relationship with boys should come second to her studies. She'll have her husband forever.
I don't let Nana V wander around the village after school. And you never see her dressed up and playing in town like other girls. She sees girls like her all around, who are the same age and about to get married. And she might be tempted if we're not there to support her. She's just a drop of water in the sea. Will Nanavive have the strength of character to resist the bullies?
I have no boyfriends among my friends. I don't talk with boys. I actually love being in middle school. I want to be a doctor so I can give people shots. I want to go to school until I become something great. They promised we'd have less books on Fridays, but my backpack weighs 20 pounds, and it's hard.
We don't have textbooks, one per child. Like a group of five may have one textbook for maths. So that means they have to do the homework in the school.
We need a lamplight to study. Sometimes I don't have that money to buy kerosene, so I don't study at night.
It's geometry. You're driving me crazy with geometry.
Do you your homework?
Yes. I do my homework every day.
A big problem is we're missing classrooms. Last year, for example, we had classes outside by the trees, and a snake fell out of the tree.
Every morning, to get ready for school, I order my notebooks according to the sequence of the classes. I need books because I don't want to stop going to school. Teenager with a huge soul of a child. I haven't changed at all. I'm just as smiley, crazy, and I can't wait for the summer, because that's when they open the carousel that swirls us upside down that I like so much.
Raluca Efimescu is 13 years old and in the throes of adolescence in a country going through its own transformations. The most recent member of the European Union, Romania is racing to catch up to its richer neighbors and cultivating a new generation of 21st century go-getters.
I want to be someone, an economist or an accountant. I like to write a lot. I hope to learn Japanese as much as I can. I like to make friends in different cities and countries and to have as many friends as possible. Raluca changes every year. It just seems like she grew up too fast, and we almost want her to still be a child.
In 2003, 7-year-old Raluca had landed a spot in one of Bucharest's finest schools. It was 45 minutes away. Her parents both worked and couldn't take her. But her education was paramount, so they let Raluca commute on her own.
She knew she's not supposed to talk to strangers.
When she was in kindergarten, she once told a lady, "I'm not allowed to talk to you because when Red Riding Hood talked to the wolf, he ate her."
Raluca's school prided itself on a rich curriculum of math, humanities, and French. Because many of her classmates came from well-to-do families, Raluca's parents felt like they had to compete.
"We're struggling to keep up with the financial situation of other parents so that the child won't feel inferior." "She's ambitious." "And she wants to do something with her life. We didn't think of that when we were kids, because you could only reach a certain level, and then you had to stop. We were all equal. It wasn't important if you were smart or not. It was important who you knew. If you knew someone who had an important position in the Communist Party.
Now you have to be very good to succeed.
Not like before."
To give Raluca the opportunities they never even dreamed of under communism, Raluca's father works all day in a printing press, and her mother holds down 2 accounting jobs.
"I work nonstop. I made a rule to stop by 5 o'clock on Saturdays and Sundays. And then I try my best to say, stop. What we hope for is that we'll be able to offer Raluca everything she needs.
Origami.
So she becomes someone."
"We never let her think that there are things that aren't possible."
Raluca's parents are not the only ones invested in her success. It has been a multi-generational effort for years now, involving regular visits to her grandmother and great-grandmother.
"Hi, Grandma.
I hear you have good grades in school. Bravo."
"Yes, I've got the first place in my class."
"First place?
She comes from school. I give her something to eat. She takes a 1-hour nap. Then we do homework. I have to take care of her. If we don't take care of them, they don't do well in school.
She'll have a beautiful, peaceful life. But she also needs to obey her parents, because her parents won't teach her bad things. Isn't that so? And the same at school. She needs to be obedient."
"I can't wait to be done with it." "With the help of the people around me, especially my grandmothers, I've come to like some things and even be fascinated by them. Like reading, listening to music. I love to write poetry.
poesia.
Evite. Azi am observat că înseamnă numai băgat, ți-e frică să mă privești, nu îndrăznești. Mă ții la distanță, nu am nicio speranță, nu vorbești, parcă ți-e teamă de mine. Îmi ascuns ceva, pot să simt asta, nu pot să mă minți, însă mă eviți. Așa. Și mai e... Era o poezie.
Raluca has changed schools since we first met her. Her new one is a pressure cooker with intense competition for high marks. The students are graded on a 1 to 10 scale, and only those who test at the very top will get into the best high schools.
I felt from the first day that there was a huge difference between them and me. But I caught up and now I'm one of the good students. I want to be one of the best and have only tens.
She has tutoring classes. Wednesday's Romanian, Thursday's math, Friday's English, Sunday's math.
All her spare time is busy.
Tuesday is Japanese. And that's not mandatory.
It's for fun.
It's the night before a big math exam, and Raluca is mobilizing her support system.
Based on this mark, I could end up in a good high school or a bad one. My future depends on it.
It's a practice test for the bigger one all Romanian kids must take to get into high school. But to Raluca, it's packed with pressure.
I really don't have to get a 10, at least above a 9.5, or a 9. I hope I get at least an 8.
Paolo, sunt speriată, mâine la 10 în parcare, da? Ok. Și fărin și fărin, mică au gândit-o ca mine. Deci până la urmă, 0 de rezultat. Deci nu este minus 4? Nu, este 0.
Încearcă să se adună, nu este liște, este relaxezi.
Am febră?
Nu-i, mamă, stai că nu s-a încins creierul.
Mai ales cu gândul, trebuie să se liniștească. Dacă nu se liniștește cu... intră în panică, degeaba cumva.
Este o vârstă mare, mică, mă, Cristi, ca să-l supui la un astfel de stres. Stresul este mare.
Și nu mai dăm la școală?
Last night was the most difficult night I've ever had. It was a very long night, and I woke up with a headache. So before every test, I use this because it kills the germs. And this is my lucky perfume. I know it'll be lucky for me because the smell helps me remember a lot of stuff. I hope it doesn't run out too quickly. Today is a very difficult day for me. I hope the test will be easy and I hope I won't panic, because I tend to panic whether I know the answers or not. God gives me confidence.
So how was it?
It was very easy, and yet very hard. I wish I could take a long bath and sleep a lot. We might get the result tomorrow. I pray to God that the math results come after the holidays. At least if I get a bad mark, it'll be after Santa came with presents.
Raluca's grade came before Santa did. She got an 8. But it's not the end of the world. The big test to get into high school is still a year away.
În întreaga lume depinde. Pot fi copii săraci care să nu au parte de ceea ce avem majoritatea, să trăiască în sărăcie și să nu aibă parte nici măcar de o pâine. Marea problemă a copiilor, sau să n-aibă pe cineva alături de ei, la bine și la greu, care să facă temele, să discute diferite lucruri.
Care crezi că sunt cele mai mari probleme ale copiilor din țara ta?
Depinde, cel puțin tot așa sunt copii săraci care vin din alte țări, încerc să-și găsească aici o casă, de obicei sunt tachinați de ceilalți din jurul lor și asta mi se pare cel mai urât lucru. Și temele care sunt de obicei prea multe și nu mai găsim timp pentru noi.
Cam câte ore pe zi stai?
Păi de obicei stau vreo 3 ore, dacă nu chiar 4 câteodată, ne dau foarte multe teme și chiar nu mai poți rezista la un moment dat.
Let us pray.
Where is God? Over there. Everywhere. Literally everywhere. I worship the voodoo idol called Mulu Agbo. I don't go to church. In church I feel good. I really feel good, which is odd, because I don't feel good everywhere I go. Religion is the best thing. When a person doesn't have religion, it's as if he doesn't have a name. Do you believe in God? I do not believe in God. No.
Father, I say thank you in the name of Jesus Christ, dear Lord. Father, may you gain them all. Father, may you have the mighty King in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I think if I go to school and God helps me, I'll become a pilot or a mechanical engineer.
I want to be just a pilot.
No, it's not a pilot. It's an engineer. I messed up. I want to be an engineer when I grow up.
This is where I've been living since I was born.
I want, when I grow up, to live in a better place.
Joe Bonyando and his younger siblings live on a hill outside of Nairobi, Kenya, in a vast squatters camp called Kibera. It's the largest slum in Africa. There's no running water, no sanitation, no electricity for the million people living in this square mile.
Now it's me as the elder, and then Gerald and Feligo. We all stay by ourselves most of the week. I'm the leader in the house.
Job is 15 and in the 6th grade at Ayani Primary School.
We started off with the peoples of Eastern Africa and we said there are four main groups. Let's revise this. Which are the four main groups of people? Yes, Job?
Hushites.
Hushites, very good.
Job is position 8 out of about 61 children and that is very good. Because I know his circumstances and his environment that he's brought up is quite difficult. And I keep telling him, you can make it in life. And I want you to be a great man.
My favorite subject is science. Because anything you do, even if you are at home, anyway, you're just doing science. When I grow up, I want to be an engineer because I like making things like ships. I cannot achieve my dreams without going to school.
When we first met Job, he was starting first grade at the age of 10. Kenya had just abolished primary school fees for the first time, offering every child in the country a free education. And over a million new students poured into the school system, along with Joe. His class had one teacher and 74 pupils.
Job is a bright boy, very enthusiastic and ready to learn.
Job lived with his father, Alfred, who was unemployed, and his mother, Leah, who took care of Job and his two siblings full-time.
Oh God, bless this food before I take it in Jesus' name.
The way I see it, if he goes to school, his life will improve tremendously. And he'll be able to get me out of this misery. So I always encourage him to read and learn, so that he can come to help me much later.
I think the school is the beginning of life. Like in Kenya, if you don't go to school, you don't get job, even you cannot survive.
Correct?
Job seemed poised to succeed in school, but some months after our first visit, his mother became ill. She died at the age of 28. Spread in the community that Job's mother had died because of AIDS.
There's a problem with the people around here because if they find anybody who is sick and died, people just say that is HIV. That's the problem. Yeah, to spoil your name, to spoil the name of the family. You see.
When my mother died, nobody didn't want us, even his friends. Now even when we were playing with their children, they were chasing us away.
Job dropped out of school and disappeared for a month.
I think the playmates were trying to lure him to go to the streets. Here in Kibera, a street child, they sniff glue in order to forget their problems.
Job's teachers went out on the streets of Kibera searching for him.
When we found him, he told me, teacher, I didn't know where I was heading to. But now that I've come back to school, I will not let you down again.
Now, in 2009, Job is facing a new reality at home. His father has remarried and moved in with his wife, leaving Job and his siblings to mostly fend for themselves.
When my father left us, everything changed. I wake up at 5:30 on school days, go take a bath, put on my school uniform. In the morning, everyone minds his business. Then we leave. Nowadays, we have less food. So I make sure that my brother and sister have eaten, or they cannot survive. We have to share which we have. You cannot put all your mind that in the evening I'm going to have my dinner. You must always think, what if it's not there?
The daily struggle to survive has not crushed Job's determination to keep working for a better life.
Job has been in the streets, and he knows what the street life is. So I'm happy that now he does not miss class any day. That is an achievement.
Now that Job and his siblings are mostly on their own, his school has chosen them for a special food aid program that helps the neediest children. He picks up the life-saving rations twice a week.
The food aid program gives him a time to know that they will have something to eat. They end up having quite enough for their family. We insist that this food is directly used by the children who collect it, not any other person. And it is important that the guardians or the parents are informed of that.
Good evening. I just came to see how they are, how they have survived the whole day, and what they did in school. After my wedding, I've been having a lot of problem because I've never worked somewhere. They got some vegetables. So I can take a piece or two pieces for my consumption on the other side. We help each other. Yes.
Sometimes I feel angry at my father. Sometimes you feel as if why my mother was the one to die. My father would have died to take her place, and then we would remain with her. I have to overcome that because he's my father. He was the one who took care of me when I was still young. My father has not left us any money to buy some food. If there's no food, we will just sleep.
When we returned to film our students in 2009, we brought along footage from our earlier visits. In Benin, the whole village came to watch.
I was a little girl, and now I've grown up a little.
In Afghanistan, the family gathered. For some, it was a rare opportunity to see what life is like in other parts of the world. For our teenagers, a chance to reach out to their counterparts in other countries.
I'd like to meet the other boys and girls in the film so that we'd have the opportunity to exchange ideas and points of view.
They had lots of questions for each other.
Raluca, how long does it snow for? You seem to enjoy it. You run around. I'm scared of snow. There's nothing to be afraid of. If you let snow, you know it's beautiful. You'd like it if you saw it.
Sugarfa, I've seen you with this cloth on your head. Aren't you hot when it's hot?
Niraj, you don't look scared when you tended the cows. Me, I'm afraid. Once a cow lifted me and threw me down, so I don't like to be near them.
Raluca and Ken are chatting in real time.
Tennis, volley, baseball, and something else. And you?
Baseball.
Oh. Do you practice baseball in your free time?
Yes.
Do you like origami?
Yes.
Job and Nanavi are having a different conversation.
Nanavi, how did you feel when your father died? Me, when my mother died, I felt as if even me, I wanted to die too.
Job, when my father died, I felt like dying too.
Nanavi, you should just go to school and help your mother in any way, because now she's your mother and she's your father.
For millions of children around the world, school is the only hope for a better life. Yet the pressures to drop out are overwhelming. The world has made a promise to give every single child a basic education by the year 2015. We'll be revisiting our 7 children in years to come to see if that promise is kept. And now, they'll be keeping an eye on each other as well.
Jefferson, even if you hear the gunshots, try to overcome them. Just mind your business, go to school, and you'll make it.